Now, the Kizashi. It's been a big learning curve for Suzuki. Despite being a fairly large car with a lot of features and priced rather well, it really did not make any noise at the cash counters. But then Suzuki said, you know what, you're better off doing hatchbacks and crossovers, let the sedans be. Maruti, however, has better ideas because what we have here is a new sedan. Suzuki calls it Ciaz, Maruti calls it Ciaz. Because this car is called the Ciaz, let's begin at the rear, because that is where the logo sits, and that's the only common design element between the concept and the production form. As you would expect, the production version doesn't look as radical and it's also smaller. Those LED tail lamps from the concept, they've made way for more conventional units that look like the Honda City's tail lights. And to make sure that the tailgate doesn't look too drab, Maruti has also included these appliques on the bumper, and they look inspired from the Honda Mobilio. The Ciaz has a clean design, the lines are simple, there's just the right amount of chrome, so 16-inch alloys look really good. Now those headlamps, they seem like they came from the Vauxhall Vectra, and that grille is reminiscent of the SX4. This car has a very European design, but ironically, it is made for the Indian and the Chinese market. And the Chinese market bit could have something to do with why these various design bits look so inspired. But jokes apart, it's all come together to make this car look sporty yet elegant. And if you ask me, I think it's worked rather well. The elegance continues to the large cabin that the Ciaz boasts of. The layout is simple and the sharing of parts with other Maruti Suzuki cars is visible, but the cabin still feels fresh and well put together. The waterfall theme seen in the Swift and the Kizashi makes its way into this center console too. It integrates a custom-made touchscreen infotainment system that runs the Nokia Hear Maps. The interface is easy to use but slow to respond. There is voice recognition too that claims to understand most Indian accents. The audio and telephony have additional controls on the steering wheel, but Maruti has paid more attention to ergonomics than design symmetry. Let's talk about the rear seat comfort then. Now this front seat is retracted all the way back. My driving position is much further ahead, and despite that, I have a good amount of knee room. The foot space is good. Under thigh support though could have been better. Headroom, as you can see, is quite good. What I really like is the angle of the backrest. The recline angle is good, so on a long distance journey, it's going to be comfortable. Adding more comfort is the center armrest. And you also have rear AC vents and an additional 12-volt socket, which again are going to come in handy on your long drives. And because this floor is pretty much flat, and because this AC unit doesn't really intrude into your rear seat space, I think placing three adults on the rear seat shouldn't be a problem at all.
The only downside is the light-colored upholstery, which gets soiled easily. And of course, the scratchy plastics. Because the government doesn't allow window tinting anymore, the Ciaz comes with blinds for the rear windshield and optional blinds for the rear windows. A good move that. What adds to the feel-good factor are the soft-touch inlays for the doors, the flush-mounted reading lamps, and the weighted grab handles. The Ciaz is a well-kitted-out car then, and an impressive package for the chauffeur-driven type. But what if you like driving the car yourself?
For the Ciaz, Maruti Suzuki is offering two engine options, same as the Ertiga, a 1.4 petrol and a 1.3 diesel. The one I'm driving is the 1.4. Now compared to the Ertiga's engine, this is also a K-series engine, it's a 1.4 K-series. However, the tuning, the overall setup is much different. For beginners, it has better thermal efficiency, it's got lesser frictional losses, some lighter components as well. And what it has resulted into is an engine that is more refined. However, for this car, there is a fair amount of engine noise that still creeps into the cabin. This engine puts out 92 PS of power and 130 Nm of torque. And those figures certainly aren't big for the size of the car that the Ciaz is. And considering you have competitions from the 1.5 iVTEC of the Honda City and the 1.6 litre engine from the Verna, which have really better figures like 118 PS and 128 PS output, this car certainly feels underpowered. The low-end torque is quite decent, there's a good top-end as well, but the mid-range, that is what is missing. So when you're out on the highway or even in the city, pulling overtakes can become a problem. You will need to downshift every now and then. Maruti Suzuki will have two gearbox options for the 1.4-litre petrol variant. There'll be a 4-speed automatic which will be added at a later stage.
for now, at launch you'll only get the 5-speed manual, and that's the one I'm driving right now. Like most of the Maruti Suzuki cars, the throws for the gear stick are quite long, but the gearbox itself is quite smooth. But do not expect an AMT version to come into the Ciaz, because Maruti wants to restrict that to the smaller cars, something that is designed for the city driving conditions. The Ciaz petrol claims to achieve a fuel economy figure of 20.73 kilometers to a liter, and that is a tall claim. But then this is a small 1.4 liter engine, and this is a light car, so that should be achievable as far as the tests go. However, in the real world conditions, I'm guessing somewhere between 14 to 16 kilometers to a liter should be the achievable figure. But let's wait for a road test and see what the real figures are.
The Ciaz uses an all-new modular ultra-lightweight platform that makes extensive use of steel to drop weight. So despite its long and wide body, the Ciaz weighs only 1,010 kilos with the petrol engine and about 1,100 kilos with a diesel mill. In fact, it has enabled the Ciaz diesel to make a claim of being the most fuel-efficient car in India with an ARAI certification of 26.2 kilometers to a liter.
The diesel engine option for the Ciaz comes in the form of a DDIS-200. Now, it is essentially the 90 PS version of the multi-jet engine, but the 200 stands for the 200 Newton meters of torque that it produces thanks to the variable geometry turbine. Now, with a VGT, you would expect that there's absolutely no turbo lag. However, it isn't so, because the power and the surge of the torque really comes in at about 2000 to 2200 RPM. So again, here, unlike the petrol, you have better mid-range, but then the low end is what it suffers on. Top end again is decent. So in the city, you may again need to keep changing your gears, but out on the highway, overtaking is slightly better. But then again, these engines, like I said, are small, and we could have done with slightly bigger engines for a car of this size. Like the petrol engine, even the diesel engine claims to be more refined as compared to the other DDIS engines in the Maruti Suzuki lineup. There is, however, a slight bit of engine noise creeping into the cabin. You don't hear that clatter all that much, but you know there's a motor running in there. And of course, the road noise and the wind noise is also quite pronounced. So I guess Maruti could have done a slightly better job with the noise insulation. In recent times, Maruti Suzuki has been known to develop good steering systems. They're neither too stiff, they're not too light. And you would expect something similar in the Ciaz as well, and it is. However, the electronic power steering system on this is slightly different than the Swift, the Dzire or the Ertiga. It is a smaller or more compact unit, and unfortunately it doesn't feel as precise as those three cars. It has a dead at center feel, and that is something that you really need to get used to if you want to know exactly how much steering input you need to give. But it weighs up well at highway speeds and is as convenient as a Maruti Suzuki should be, even in city environments. Now let's talk about the ride and the handling of the Ciaz, but let me tell you that we have been driving on the long highway stretches of Jaipur. We've hardly encountered any turns or any bends, so I can't really talk about the vehicle's dynamics when it comes to cornering. So we'll have to wait for a proper road test for that. But from whatever we've driven so far, I can tell you that the suspension is tuned more towards better ride comfort than outright handling. The suspension is slightly softer. There is a slight bit of body roll. It's not unnerving though, despite the vehicle's light weight. But then it doesn't feel as sporty as, say, a Linea or a Vento. It's something in the range of the Honda City or the Verna, the updated Verna, of course. Couple that with this new steering setup, and the entire setup will need a little getting used to if you really want to enjoy this car around the twisties or on your weekend drives in the ghats or in the canyons. But out on the highway, the manners are quite good. Even in the city, the vehicle has a very good ride quality. You don't get a choppy effect anywhere. You do not get those sudden jerks, sudden thuds. So I think overall, they've got the setup quite well.
The top spec trim comes with 195 section tires. The grip seems fairly good, and even under hard braking, the car doesn't lose composure. The anti-lock brakes largely contribute to that effect and are standard on all but the base variant. Same for the driver airbag. Good to see that Maruti Suzuki is starting to take safety seriously. Let's sum it up then.
Now, like most new governments that aim at fixing the shortcomings of their predecessors, the Ciaz also fixes everything that was wrong with the SX4. It looks better, it feels better, it drives better, and also has a better equipment list. But unlike most governments, the Ciaz should live up to all its promises. We'll be right back.